Well, welcome to The Edge. My name is Tony Woodall. I'm one of the preachers, one of the teachers here at the church, and I'm excited to bring you a word that's been cultivating in my heart for a little while. And we're going to be closing out this series called Stop, Drop, and Roll. It's a four-part series, and so the last word, roll, has some more L's in it. So we're just going to keep rolling. CheesyChurchJokes.com coming at you. You guys doing okay? Okay, all right. We are going to defy the darkness outside. Got to get them going, Brannick. You know what I'm saying? It's like Sleepy Town. Oh, woo! There you go. Love you, man. Everybody needs a woo man, you know? Anyway, we're going to be rolling through Stop, Drop, and Roll. I'm excited because next week we're kicking off our series Life and Doctrine, though we might change it to Love and Doctrine because it actually sounds better than Life and Doctrine. That might be a prophetic word that you brought earlier today. Yes, I know. She was in the spirit. But anyway, no, Life and Doctrine. We're excited to talk about what it means to know God and what that does for us in the world and how that translates into how we see the world. So Life and Doctrine is coming up next week, and our fearless leader, Steve Van Denend, woo, is going to lead us in Life and Doctrine. With that, I have a little word to finish us off called, They Were Called Christians. They were called Christians. And so what I want to do is I want to get my pink Bible. It's a true story. I do have a pink Bible right here, and we're going to read Acts chapter 11. You guys there? Chapter 11, verse 19. We're going to start in 19, and we're going to roll through to verse 26. Are you guys there? On your smartphones, on your semi-smartphones, and in your paper? I like the paper. I'm old school. I like the paper. Who likes the paper? Who has paper? I'm just curious. Yeah, you know, we're 50-50. The Midwest usually is slow to uptick on the technology, but that's okay. Oh, that's okay. I like the paper. So we're here. Acts chapter 11. We're going to start in verse 19, right? And I am excited about this story. I was praying. I was feeling angsty. I was feeling out of sorts. And so I asked the word. I said, Lord, I don't want to go to any news channel. I don't want to ask people's opinion. I don't want to read any blogs. I don't want to write any blogs. I want to be quiet. I want to listen. And I want to come to your word, Lord. And the Lord opened up this scripture for me. And I want to share what he said. Sometimes you just got to go to the word. Amen. That was a great part of Steve's message last week, is that if we're going to keep our eyes on Jesus, we're going to be led by the word. So let's get into the word. Acts chapter 11, verse 19. Now those who were scattered because of the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. But there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who on coming to Antioch spoke to the Hellenists, that is Greek-speaking non-Jews also, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was on them. And a great number who believed turned to the Lord. The report of this came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. And when he came, he saw the grace of God, and he was glad, and he exhorted them to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. And a great many people were added to the Lord. So Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul, who we know as Paul later on in the story. And when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. And for a whole year they met with the church and taught a great many people. And in Antioch, the disciples were first called Christians. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just love the way you work. I love the way you worked in history. I love the way you knitted it all together. Lord, you truly turn all evil to good for those who love you. And Lord, the church in Antioch got a hold of something that we need today. They were the first ones on the planet to ever be labeled as followers of you, to clearly be delineated out of the world by the world. The world called them Christians. And we just have to believe, with faith and with hope, we have to believe that there is something that we can learn from the first church that ever was known as the Christian church, about what it means to live today, what it means to be in Christ today, and yes, what it means to be a Christian today. And Lord, I lay down any agenda. I'm not seeking an endorsement for my thoughts. I'm seeking your face. And I pray, Lord, that all of us, with a sincere and pure devotion, Lord, can just lay down our thoughts and pick up your spirit. So we just release grace in this room. We release an anointing of revelation in this room, Lord, not because I'm anything special, but because you are, and because we want to see your face. Do we want to see his face? So we just release that grace over me and us for the greater glory of your name, Jesus. Amen. So I posed a question on Facebook yesterday, and I asked people if they ever had a nickname growing up. And many of you responded, and there were some really funny ones. What I learned out of that exercise of asking questions is there's a lot of healing that needs to happen around the nickname thing. I also learned that, like, dads are really cheesy, because it seems like the dads don't give up. Like, there are men and women who are, like, 30, 40, 50 years old who are like, yeah, I'm called Wooly Booger, and my dad still calls me that. I'm 55. You know, it's like, okay, let's just pray for you to work through. Obviously, there's some pain, but nicknames are really cool, because really what happens is sometime in our life, maybe for a dad it's just enough to be born, but sometime in our life we have this moment where something kind of defines us, and then we are called that, right? Anybody ever had that happen where, like, you are known for something? So this happened to me, and I'll reveal now the great reveal of what my nickname was. I know. Thank you, Nordic Princess Warrior. That's what I call Hillary. I never forget one time, I was, like, driving home from work, and there's, like, 15 feet of snow, and she's running. And I'm like, who is this Nordic Princess Warrior? That's what I called her. And it just stuck with me anyway. So anyway, but here was my nickname. So when I went into ninth grade, I had some acne. Yeah, I had some acne. And that wasn't bad enough, but I had this glorious, life-defining zit right here on my lip. It was like, it was competing with, like, real estate for my nose on my face, okay? And so for the whole year, and some people still remind me, for the whole year I was called Zit Lip. I'm not bitter. I'm not bitter at all. I'm hoping this is part of my healing. But, you know, like it was just like that zit was so amazing that it became the defining moment of my face, the defining moment of my ninth grade and 10th grade years of high school. It was beautiful. But perhaps, like, the most amazing nickname story I've ever come across is I was at university, and I was broke as a joke, and so the university gave me a job, and I was working with all these guys, and they were just guys. They were just guys up in Saginaw, Michigan, and they would, like, change light bulbs, and I think it's called, like, physical plant is what it's called, I think. But they, like, change light bulbs, and they do electrical things, and they clean up stuff, and they fix stuff. They go to dorms. And I was hanging out with these guys, and they were interesting folks. And one of them was called Zinger. Zinger. He was, like, a 6'5", all red hair, all red beard, wild man. He was really wild. And they called him Zinger, and that was his name. I don't even know what his name is today, but his nickname was Zinger. And I found out one day why. So there's a little vending machine in this place where we would gather for breaks. And in that vending machine, they had these. Zingers. Anybody know what a zinger is? Yeah. Arguably the best Hostess snack on the planet. And Charlie Sims was ready to go to blows with me on that this morning. But I don't want to cause dissension in the church. I just happened to, yeah, I know. What's the best one, Charlie? What is it?
I don't have the best one. It's the whole thing.
Anyway, you know, you got to be bold when you preach, Charlie. I'm telling you right now. Jesus told me. No. But anyway, so And so I went, and I'm like, man, there's like nothing in there. I'm not really a salty guy. So I saw this, and it was the last one, and I grabbed it. And everyone went, uh-oh. And I'm looking around. I didn't know it, but this big 6'5" redheaded guy was called Zinger because he was crazy for these things. And I took the last one, and I gave it to him. I'm going to try to turn a corner into something spiritual. What had happened was with Zinger was that he was so affectionately interested in this hostess snack that he actually, his nickname became Zinger. That's what he was known for. Still don't know much about him. I hope he survived the 2000s. This guy was wild. We get a nickname because something about us supersedes everything else that's about us, and we become that thing, amen? And in Antioch, they became Christians for the first time in the history of the church. I want to give a little bit of background on why they became. It seems so simple. Yeah, well, they believed in Jesus. They're Christians. But let me give a little background. The book of Acts that we're reading, the book of Acts is really, it's a book that covers the earliest days of the church after Jesus rises from the grave and ascends to heaven. And many of us know that church started in Jerusalem, right? The church really was founded and started in Jerusalem, and it started with the Jewish people. And for many years in the earlier days, like the first decade and a half or so, it was really just kind of known, like the Christian thing was really just kind of known as like an extra Jewish thing. It was just kind of like the Jews were the ones who were believing in Jesus. The Jews were the ones who were really grabbing a hold of Jesus. And they became these followers of Jesus, but they're really still kind of known as Jews. And so there's a lot of consternation in the early Jewish movement to figure out like where Jesus fits in. Can we be Jewish and be Christian and all this kinds of stuff? And so for many years in the early stages anyway, there were these people called the Jews. Some of them believed in Jesus. They were a very small group. Very exclusive. Now, Stephen, we read it earlier in the story that we just read. Stephen is a guy in the early church who rises up and in great boldness, he was a Jewish guy, in great boldness begins to tie the Old Testament to Jesus and begins to prove that Jesus is the Messiah for the Jewish people. And for that, the big thank you curtain call was he got stoned to death. He got rocked to sleep. Another cheesy church joke. Moving on. Got your attention. Good. He got stoned to death, all right? So then what happened was is that many of the Jewish Christians got afraid, rightly so, and they began to disperse all throughout the Roman world, the Middle East and the Roman world, and they began to go to different places. And we read that after Stephen was persecuted, many of them went to different cities, and many of them landed in Antioch. And Antioch became a really big deal. We read from our text that the church grew so fast, it was full of life, that even the founding church of Jerusalem, the Jewish Christians, had to take notice of this church. And so they began to send leadership into Antioch to see what was going on. And so they sent Barnabas, and sometimes we hear in Scripture that Barnabas is an encourager, and he definitely is here. So they send an apostle called Barnabas to encourage the Antioch church. And then he realizes, like, what's happening in Antioch is such a big deal that he needs more help. And so he goes and gets this guy named Saul from a place called Tarsus. What's really interesting about Saul, who was a recent convert to Christianity, is that it was Saul that oversaw the persecution of Stephen. Think about that. Someone rises up and kills the first martyr. And then 15, 16 years later, he comes back and he serves the church. Praise God. And so Paul and Barnabas, they stay in Antioch for a year. And that's a really big deal because it was kind of harder to stay and travel back then. So they came and stayed in Antioch for a year. And then lastly, we find in the story, they became Christians first. In Antioch. And what I mean by that is the outside world was looking at this church, this movement, and they were trying to label it as something, and they couldn't label it as something, and so they called it Christian. That's why it says in the Bible that they were called Christians first in Antioch. So then we have to ask ourselves, what is the difference between what happened in Antioch and what happened prior? Why did they get the distinction of being the first church to be called Christian? And I want to give a little bit of historical narrative there, and I want to use an analogy of the iPhone. Who has an iPhone? How many of us have an iPhone? Because you're the cool kids, right? So how many of you know that iPhone is made by a company called Apple? And what did Apple start out making back in like the early 80s? They began to making computers, right? Remember that really famous commercial where like this is big screen. It's 1984. There's this big screen and like there's all these drones and they're marching to this some kind of like solemn speech. And all of a sudden this woman comes around the corner and throws a sledgehammer at the screen. And then we're all freed from the shackles of Dell and IBM, and now we're free to worship the, anyway. But the idea, though, is Apple came out with computers, and they really marketed themselves differently. The computer space was getting crowded. It was very kind of convoluted and all that. And so they began to market themselves differently. And what they did was they said, look, we're not for everybody. But if you want to go against the status quo, and if you want to be cool, then you will buy an Apple computer. And so they had a very small market. They had a very narrow purpose. And many people bought it. But, you know, even today, their sales of computers never gets above 10% of the total market share. Because they still kind of, in the computer realm, they still kind of have that one little sliver. They got into the design side. I don't want to get on the marketing. But they had one little sliver. But then something happened in 2007 that just blew Apple wide open. And what was that? iPod came before that. The iPhone was really the game changer, right? So then the iPhone comes out in 2007, and Steve Jobs has a vision, and he says, I'm going to put a computer in everyone's hand. I'm going to create a smartphone. And then the world goes crazy for these things. And all of a sudden now, the little eclectic, kind of cool little company called Apple becomes this international success story where now everybody is looking at getting after this iPhone because this new category has opened up, and it's become a ubiquitous marketing plan, and now everybody's clamoring to get an iPhone. Even the people who aren't cool like me have an iPhone. And here's what happened. Even today, iPhone is over 60% of all the revenue of Apple. What does this have to do with Antioch? Antioch, if you look at Christianity as a brand, just for a minute, what Antioch did was they were able to open up the market to something other than the Jewish people, right? So the church starts out in Jerusalem. It's a very, very specific group of people, the Jews, a very small fraction of the Roman Empire. They begin to take on Christianity. And really, Christianity is really concerned with this little Jewish offroot at first. And then they get persecuted, so they go out into the world. And we read in Antioch that many of them still, when they came to Antioch, many of the Jews only spoke to the Jews. But there were these crazy people, these people from Cyprus and Cyrene, who opened up the market. It says, but some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, spoke to the Hellenists. That's the non-Jews. Okay, back then, just think about it this way. Jews, 5 to 8% of the whole population. Non-Jews, everyone else. Bigger market, right? And they began talking about Jesus to the non-Jews. And then it says that the Lord was pleased with that. There's also some stories earlier on with Peter where God reveals his heart for the non-Jews, for the Gentiles. And so the Lord was upon them, and the church blew up. And then before you know it, Antioch becomes a bigger brand than the founding church itself. Antioch is selling more iPhones than Apple is selling computers. There are actually now more non-Jews becoming Christians than there are Jews as Christians. That's what happened. They tapped into something different. They tapped into something bigger. They became a more ubiquitous brand, if you will. They had to send leaders. They had to send Jewish leaders down to Antioch to get a hold of this thing. And the difference that makes the difference between Antioch and the rest of the churches before is that the non-Jews also received the gospel. And for the first time in the history of the world, Jews and Greeks were living together. They were worshiping together. They were preaching Jesus. They were sharing Jesus. They were sharing fellowship. They were united in one spirit. For the first time in the history of the world, there were two way different groups of people. Let me tell you something. If you think that Republicans and Democrats are different today, you better check out. You better check out Jews and non-Jews in the first century church. They walked across every barrier, broke every barrier down, and they were living life together for the first time in thousands of years. And the people on the outside could no longer make a distinction between Jew and non-Jew in Antioch, and so they could only conclude, what is the highest common denominator of these people? And they could only conclude that it is Jesus and Jesus alone that makes the difference with those people. And so they registered them, or they called them Christians, which, by the way, back then was a derogatory term. And they earned it because they were Christians. They were bound by nothing other than this man named Jesus. Prior to Antioch, the Jews were saying Jewish first, Jesus second. And then there were people in Antioch who came along and said, no, Jesus first, everything else second. I heard a great business leader give a speech recently, and he said, they asked him about time management. And he said, here's what I do. I do first things first and second things never. You know, the church in Antioch became a Jesus thing first and nothing else second. Amen? That's what they were known for. They became Christians first. Now, of course, I know what you're probably thinking, and I definitely thought this when I was preparing this message, but, well, that was a different time. The church was just getting started. The church really didn't have an identity yet. They didn't have a brand yet. They weren't known for anything yet. It was a simpler time. It was a different time. It was 2,000 years ago. Tony, is it possible that we can simply be known as Christians today? That's a big question. There's a lot of sauce on that question. Amen? I remember when I became a Christian, radical born-again experience at 24 years old, January of 2000, I will never forget when I became a Christian, and it was everything. It was everything to me. Jesus was everything. It was the Word of God and Jesus. It was me and Jesus and the Word of God, and that was it. And I told everyone, simply, I told everyone that I was a Christian. I was a Christian. And immediately, I learned that many people, both non-believers and believers, have a lot of ideas about what that brand means today. Right? There were a lot of people, non-believers, when I told them that I was a Christian, they automatically assumed that I was Ned Flanders from The Simpsons. Like, I'm going to be some kind of doormat who just says, "Hi, ho, neighbor." I don't know if that's how he says it. Yeah. Howdy doodly, sure, Homer, take all my food. Yeah, I don't know what he said, but really, there was this idea. I'm trying. There was this idea. I don't like The Simpsons. I don't know. I'm trying to be relevant. It's even like an old show. But there was this idea. There was this idea that if you were a Christian, then you were Ned Flanders. You were like this little wallflower guy who didn't have a lot to say, and you were a pushover, and everything was bright and sunny no matter what, you know? And I'm like, well, I don't want to be known as that. And then there were other people that I met who just thought I was a dumb person. Oh, you're a Christian, therefore you're not into science. You can't be rational. You have fanciful beliefs. And then there were other people, my friends, my friend group before I became a Christian, who began calling me a goody two-shoes. Oh, man, now we can't drink and get in fights together, Tony. I'm like, well, we can still fight, but no. You know, I grew up with some folks, you know, and they were really upset because, man, I was like the life of the party, you know. And they called me goody two-shoes because now I'm just going to be good and it's going to be boring. And all the things that the world loves, I'm going to walk away from. I'm not going to have any more fun. And I'm going to wear penny loafers or something. And I never forget this. I had one guy, he was horrified that I became a Christian. And he said that I worship a vengeful, bloody, horrible God, because what kind of father would openly kill his son? You worship a God of cosmic child abuse, he said. You know, and so early on in my faith, I didn't want to be labeled as Ned Flanders, Goody Two-Shoes, child abuser. And that was just the non-believers. Then I start talking to believers. I start talking to Christians, self-identified Christians, about what it meant to be Christian. And I was just in the faith. I'm trying to figure it out. And they're like, well, yeah, well, now you're a believer, and surely you don't celebrate Halloween now. I'm like, man, but I like Halloween. It was fun. I was a pink. I was a little kid. We couldn't afford candy, and that's the only time I got candy. You're going to take candy away from me? Anyway, so you don't celebrate Halloween, right? You don't celebrate Christmas. You know, in Jeremiah 10, it says that if you chop down a tree, that you worship the devil. I'm like, man. True stuff, you know. They were like, well, surely you don't drink at all, not even a little bit, nothing. Like, not water? Like, you know. And you know, then I found the other people. Well, that's good that Jesus found you, but have you really found Jesus? Because if you've really found Jesus, then you would this, this, and this. And if you do that, that, and that, that means that you're filled with the Spirit, and that means you're good to go. And so before I knew it, whether it was a non-believer trying to label my Christianity, or whether it was the church trying to label my Christianity, quickly I ascertained, as a young 20-something-year-old man, that I can't just be Christian. I have to have qualifiers and asterisks, and I have to have a contract. Like every time I tell someone I'm a believer, I got to put a contract down. Now, it doesn't mean this, and it doesn't mean that, and on Saturdays it means this, and on Sundays it means that. You know, do you feel me on this? It's confusing being a Christian nowadays. And what about today? Here we are now, right? 16, 17 years later. You ready? What about the political landscape? You can throw up, Becky. It's okay. Well, if you're a Christian, then surely you believe this. Or surely you believe that. And how can you call yourself if you? And if I was a Christian, I would never. Right? I'm not definitely going to solve. I'm not going to solve it this morning. So just chill out on that thought. But I think the purpose of this point is that can we even call ourselves Christians today? Back to Antioch. They were first called Christians there. They put the person of Jesus Christ before the expression of their individual faith. They put the person of Jesus Christ before the individual expression of their faith. The Jews were asking, what does it look like to be Jewish and be a Christ follower? And then others began to ask, Jews included, who is Jesus? Who is Jesus? I think what happens this happened to me early on, is we get so caught up in trying to express our faith our way that we miss the simple fact that Christianity is not an accessory to your lifestyle or my lifestyle. Christianity is a person. His name is Jesus, and we follow him. Amen? I mean, how do we get so lost as to what it means to be a Christian? I've heard many say lately, and some would say, well, it's impossible to come to objective truth because everyone has their own perspective. You've heard that before? It is impossible to come to objective truth because everyone has their own perspective. And then they would point to the chaos in the church as evidence of that claim. But as I pray about this, and as I look at this, and as I consider church history, and as I let Antioch impress upon me the word of God, what I think is that we do not have a truth issue, we have a heart issue. God says to his people over and over again in the scripture, he says, if you seek me with all your heart, you will find me. This truth crisis is not a truth crisis. It's a heart condition. He says, seek me first. Get to know me as a person first. And you will seek me with all your heart and you will find me. And then it goes on to say, if you lack wisdom, ask. And the Father will grant you. But if you don't know God as the Father, then you won't get the wisdom of the world from him. Amen? What I'm saying is that we have to put the face of Jesus before the agenda of Jesus as worked out through us. It's a heart issue. When Jesus, for the first time in his ministry, sat down thousands of people to teach, we know that as the Sermon on the Mount. He starts right out. There are many people, they had lots of motives and agendas. They had lots of thoughts about who Jesus was. They had lots of opinions about Jesus and Rome and Herod and what is the Sanhedrin. And they were in a political mess back then, like nothing that we can even comprehend today, like nothing that we are in today. They were in a mess. And when Jesus finally sat them down to teach them, the first thing he said, and it was a qualifier that was a gateway to everything else he was going to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God." And what he was saying was, is that all of us, all of you, he was saying, all of us need to lay down what we think we know and get to know the Creator who knows everything. We come with humility. We come with an honest heart. We seek his face. And then everything else is added to us. Amen? And lately I've been praying, and the Lord asked me a tough question. The Lord asked me a tough question. And if this is something that you can resonate with, grab a hold of it, okay? I was praying about things, and the question was, in our seeking of God, are we looking for an endorsement or a relationship? Amen? What are we looking for in our seeking? What are we looking for in our seeking of God? Are we looking for an endorsement or a relationship? Because you know what? We get ourselves in a bind because we put our agenda above God. And we sought God's endorsements of our ideas before we sought his face. And God is not in the endorsement business. He's in the relationship business. Amen? He wants to relate to us. He wants to come alongside us and love us and breathe life on us and unite us together by the spirit of love. And then he wants to pour out, and then he wants to tell us what he thinks about this, that, and the other. And by the way, he's got an opinion on everything. He really does. He's God, God of all. He says, "Seek my face with a pure heart." Now, does this mean that our beliefs about the issues of the day don't matter? No. Our beliefs about the issues of the day matter. We're the church. We are the people of God. We are set apart in communion with the living God. And so what we think matters, folks. Amen? What we think and what we believe about the issues of the day matter, because we have to be a voice that represents Jesus. Our beliefs about, but see, here's where it starts, though. Our beliefs about who God is and his presence will have a direct impact on who we are in the world. Amen? What we say is good. What we say is evil. And how we think critically about the world around us. What is our worldview? What we think about the things around us matter. But listen, what matters first, and why Antioch got it right, and why we can learn from them today, is that we are Christians first. We seek his face first. We seek his fellowship first. And we humbly submit our hearts to him first. And then we together in unity shine like a light on a hill. Because we are the hope of the world, folks. We are the hope. Amen. What I'm really excited about, I'm going to talk a little bit about our next sermon series right now, is we're going to be getting into this thing called life and doctrine. And Steve's going to start us off next week, but I'm really excited about getting into the Word of God, seeing the face of God, and actually applying it to how we operate and how we view and how we think about the world. Amen? And it's going to be a process, folks. It's going to be a process, and there's going to be a lot of shaking, and there's going to be a lot of prayer and a lot of humility and a lot of love. How about that? Prayer, humility, and love? We're going to get there because you know what, man? God has an opinion on everything. And his people do too, for sure. But here's what I know. That when we come to him in that place of humility and love, and we yield our hearts to him first, we're going to find a lot more common ground than we have today. Amen? We're going to find it because it matters. And we're a powerful force on the planet. A force for good, a force for God. All that being said, I think that being a Christian first is a lot more simpler than we make it out to be. And I believe that Antioch can teach us something today about what it means to be called a Christian first. Amen. That's really all I had. What I want to do, is that okay, folks? Yeah, I mean, we're going to, listen, folks, I know that we are living in a tumultuous time. We are living in a time of great change, great questions, a lot of fear out there. But over and over again, God's people, when they humble down and they seek his face together, they find truth together. Amen? And we're going to go there. That's where we're going next, okay? So I'm open for it. Are you guys open for it? I'm really looking forward to it. I know that Steve and I and the elders have been praying about that, really, really seeking God's face. And we really, really feel that life and doctrine is the next for the edge. Amen? Okay. With that, I want to invite the band back up, and I want to get into communion. And while the band starts making their way, we've done communion every week for this month. Have you guys liked that? We just felt like, why do you talk about unity? Just be unity. Amen? Sometimes you just do it, you know? It's a little bit easier than talking about it. So one of the things, I want to do a little bit differently this time, though. What I want to do is I want us to all do communion together. I know that we've been breaking up into smaller groups. We've been breaking up into individual little groups here and there, and we've been praying for each other. That's been awesome. But what I really want to do is I want us to get the elements down here left and right of me. There's a little juice and a little piece of bread. If you guys want to go ahead and grab one of each for yourselves, and then we're going to stay kind of right where we are in our seating arrangement. If you want to get closer to people, please do. But we're going to be taking communion together. I'll give you guys a couple minutes to do that, and we'll circle back around in the finish of this message. Amen. You guys can take a seat and get a little. They're like, man, he already preached. He's good, and I got a little bit more. Sorry about that. Be praying for this next season of the Edge. Be praying for life and doctrine. Be praying that we can get there together in love. Amen. So one of the things about Antioch is they were called Christians first. And of course, we just talked about all the reasons why that's really hard to get there today. But I prayed about it, and I really sought the Lord's face. And I asked him to give me something that we can do to hone in on that today of what it means to put him first. And as I prayed about it, I got this this word devotion. Devotion. And I looked it up, and the definition of devotion is love, loyalty, or enthusiasm for a person, an activity, or a cause. Devotion is love, loyalty, or enthusiasm for a person, activity, or cause. As I began to think about that, I realized that we can care about a lot of things, right? We can have a lot of careabouts. We can have a lot of things in our heads. We can have a lot of things in our hearts. But when it comes to giving enthusiasm and love to things, we really only can do one thing. The analogy that I remembered in prayer was, there was a time when I used to lift weights like a lot. I know you're looking at me and thinking, well, you look like Gilligan right now, so... Tony, you're a liar. I rebuke you. No, I used to. I used to lift weights. And once a week, what we would do once a week is we would lift really heavy. We would take one body group and we would just lift really heavy. And you know, when we would lift really heavy, we didn't lift anything else. It took everything within us to be able to give our maximum to that one exercise. And so we weren't looking for a workout. We were looking for a max out, right? And I think this word devotion is related to that. Like, the word devotion means that it's undivided, it's not distracted, there's nothing that gets in the way of it, that out of all the things that I care about, all the things that I love, all the things that I lobby for, all the things that I have enthusiasm about, all the things that I tell people about, there's one thing that I'm devoted to. Amen? There is one heavy lift in my life. There is one max in my life. And I think that's pretty simple, isn't it? Isn't the answer Jesus? And as I prayed about that, the Lord just told me, yeah, you got one max. You got one thing in your life, and that's me. And that's my people. So as we get ready to take communion together, let's make them the one thing, the big thing, the only thing. Amen? Okay. On the night that he was betrayed, he took bread and he lifted it to the Father and he gave thanks. And he gave the bread to his disciples and he said, "This is my body, which will be broken for you. Always do this in remembrance of me." Let's take the body. Thank you, Lord. You are our one devotion, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And after this, he took the cup and he lifted it and he thanked his Father and he said, "This is the cup of my blood. This is the blood of the everlasting covenant. When you gather in my name, do this forever in remembrance of me." Jesus, I'm just thankful that 2,000 years this side of your resurrection, Lord, we're allowed to come together for no other purpose than to love you. That we're allowed to come together for no other reason than to love your people. That out of all the things that are tracking our attention and trying to get us worked up, Lord, our enthusiasm and our love is fixed on the face, your beautiful face, Jesus. And as we move into this next season together, Lord, I pray that we put your face in front of us. We don't lose sight of your eyes, Lord, that we have eye contact with you the whole time as we sort out what it means to be people called Christians in this world. And we release special grace and favor in those hard places of our hearts that want to hold on to things that are not of you or things that we're not sure are of you. And Lord, I yield and I pray for a spirit of yieldedness for everyone here, Lord, that we can just get your heart and we can do your works, the good, perfect, and acceptable works that you've given us to do. Conform our minds to your heart and let us be of one heart and let us be of one spirit because you are one. Thank you, Lord, for your sacrifice. We yield to you in pure and undivided devotion. Amen.